Dan Smith here, director. I'll be doing some audio commentary for this re-release of the movie.
Oh, wait, not yet. Sorry, sir, this is just the DVD menu. The movie hasn't started yet.
Well, I see you dug up the original movie poster. Oh boy, that takes me back. Wow, they really pack a lot of options into DVDs, don't they? Hey, you know, back in my day, you just popped a movie into the old VCR and hit play. Hey, is this thing on? Can you? Hello, Dan Smith here. I directed this film back in, well, it feels like a century ago. Yeah. The studio asked me to provide a commentary track for the DVD release. And wham, straight into the action. No fluff or anything. That's what we did back then.
The ship's velocity reactor is damaged. I believe that I am stranded on an alien planet.
Played, of course, by actor Jonathan Digby. Went on to some minor roles after this. Such a shame. I thought from day one this guy's got leading man written all over his face. Often asked why Dick breaks these boxes. He actually ad-libbed it. I told Jonathan, always keep things exciting.
Greetings, citizens of Gravoria. I am Dick Starspeed, and I come in peace.
Probably shouldn't have had Dick draw his weapon when he was talking about peas. Well, maybe one day we'll go back and CG it into a sandwich or something instead. Ha! Just kidding. Such stunning choreography. Now, the extras in those robot suits really knew how to take a punch. Oh, literally. I told Jonathan not to hold back. Give it all to him. Kick him in the nuts and bolts. And I know what you're thinking, but don't worry. We handled it responsibly. We made them all sign waivers not to sue for injuries.
Holy smokes! If I land squarely on that grain silo, I should survive this fall unscathed.
I shouldn't say this now, but you could actually see the strings if you squinted hard enough. A screenwriting trick from back in the old days. You put a grain silo or some haystacks down, and it solves all your gravity-related problems.
It appears some of my equipment was lost when my ship was shot down. But what luck! This high-tech scanner reports that my ray gun is nearby.
The dinosaurs! just don't see quality stop motion like this anymore, do you? Someone actually sat there and moved them, frame by frame. Today, it'd be done with computers, but where's the artistry in that? A little plastic. Well, it's because they are. I took them from the set of my last film, Vampire Island 2. We got our fair share of nasty letters from scientists complaining about our portrayal of the dinosaurs. Was news to me. Apparently, these stegosauruses weren't meat eaters. Must have preferred shellfish or something. How do they know? That's what I say. Local population is defenseless. That's where our hero steps in and saves the day. Jonathan threw a lot shooting this film. He wasn't the best actor, especially when reacting to getting hit. He's what you call a flincher. So I told the stuntman to really just go to town on him. It's the only way to get an honest performance sometimes. Our props master tried to make the weapons soft, but there's only so much you can do. Lucky for us, Dick's entire body was covered in that spacesuit. That thing was a lifesaver when it came to hiding bruises.
How curious. They dissolved into what appears to be gold.
You'll notice the gold disappears when Dick touches it. We had a deleted scene that explained he's actually teleporting it back to his ship. It's funny, no one ever questioned how Dick was able to walk around with an infinite amount of gold on him. We had to redo these shots. Our first attempt was kind of a disaster. We tried using real apes, thought it'd cut down on the costume budget a bit. But have you ever tried working with apes? They are the worst actors ever. They don't sit still for a moment, and the second you take your eyes off of them, they're flinging their feces all over the place. Jonathan refused to work with them after he got, let's just say that he I had to take more than a couple of showers one day. You know, you never forget the smell of monkey poo. We steam cleaned the studio top to bottom. Still never got rid of it entirely. All through the rest of the shot, we kept finding those little surprises hiding inside various props. Boy, were those the days. Top-notch stop-motion effects, huh? Unfortunately, we skimped on the Dick Starspeed puppet a little.
The Earthman is not for you to eat, fiend!
Well, this was groundbreaking. We had the woman rescuing the man for once. We were really ahead of our time with this scene, but then again, I've always been rather progressive. The studio exec didn't seem to get why it was such a big deal, though.
Sorry, we don't see this as anything unusual.
Ha! Of course! It's unusual! A woman would never save the man. It just doesn't happen. Not in the movies, not in real life. I don't know why we didn't get more recognition for this scene. I guess I was just a little too ahead of my time.
Thank you for saving me, strange woman. What is your name?
I am the magnificent Scarlet Nova. Question my motives. Just be happy that you are still alive. I must speak with my father at once. I shall teleport to his chambers.
So we'll be seeing our first example of teleportation being used by Scarlet right here.
Where is this place? This is not my father's chambers.
You have disobeyed the inn for all eternity.
Wearing my jetpack.
Booster, use. Wait. Use booster.
Scarlet didn't quite realize she needed to shoot those energy orbs down below. Keep in mind, Stacy was doing this on a soundstage, okay?
Thank you.
GMs, such a neat effect. We had to paint each movement frame by frame and superimpose it into live footage. We were pulling all-nighters for weeks. Well, when I said we, I meant the artists. I'm pretty much useless if I don't get a solid 10 hours a night. But they were at it forever. They had to redo it all because I accidentally told them red instead of blue the first time. Artists. Ooh, the fearless sea monster, always patrolling the shore, eagerly awaiting for his next meal.
Father revoked my access to the teleport terminals. I shall only be able to utilize the ones I activate manually.
Man, some of these shots are dragging on longer than I remember.
I knew you would return.
Puny Earthman, you shall help me overthrow the Emperor.
Why would you turn against your own father? How do I know I can trust you?
This scene. This is practically Shakespeare in outer space.
Just as the entire planet does.
Huh? Patrick, what's wrong with the video?
Sorry, sir. Technical problems.
Darn it, we're missing some really good writing here.
There, sorry about that.
Well, we just passed right by her big scene. Basically, they agree to work together, but one must stay behind in the sleep chamber at all times.
Should I rewind?
Never mind, I'll continue from here. Right from the start, our budget was a little tight, even by standards back then. To make do, Tony shot a couple scenes in black and white. Originally, he intended to use it for flashbacks. But then I had to break it to him. Our film doesn't have flashbacks. We almost made it a silent film just to cut costs. Necessity we have a T-Rex in this film, but we got this Serato thing instead. Of course, I went through the whole production thinking it was a T-Rex because, really, who can tell the difference anyway? Yeah.
It would appear that now is the time for us to climb the Deadly Tower of Monsters.
Good screenwriting 101. Always announce the title within the film itself. How else are you going to let the audience know your heroes really mean business? Now, that weapon? It's just an electric shaver, but you know, I bet you'd never guess it was, would you? They look so futuristic. Use of that one at some of our meetings with the studio. Oh, you'd like to see records of where our budget went to this month? Sure, let me get that for you right now. Foom, foom. Unfortunately, those meetings ended in a much different way. Taxidermist who helped us out with these bat creatures for real cheap. He's not good. So he's kind of sloppy if you want to know the truth. But that's the best part. A sloppy bat looks scarier. Oh, but you gotta sew up that sphincter. Just trust me on that one.
Thank you.
the squids. Some board member had these nephews who really wanted to be in the films. They made me cast them as squids. Whatever happened to artistic integrity? If you're going to cast a role not on merit, at least let it be a hot female role. My effects team kept assuring me the strings wouldn't be visible in the final cut, but I could see them. No transparent nylon. This stuff will do the trick. Yeah, right. I swear, those darn strings is what made my hair go white.
Teleport usage. Jump. While in the air, use teleport. Quickly return to upper floor.
Miss a single minute of this scene. The nuclear ants. Hey, we need to remind the audience our heroes are climbing a tower, so I needed something that would stick to walls. Originally, we had these web-footed what-have-yous. Not very scary. And then I left some cake out in my trailer, and it was crawling with ants in the morning. And that's when it hit me. What is the most obnoxious thing in the world? That a simple wooden cage would have such an elaborate high-tech lock. But hey, if a Gravorian ever traveled to Earth, I'm sure they'd think a lot of our stuff is weird too.
Thank you.
Oh no! This head belonged to my co-pilot robot. He was the most loyal companion in the galaxy.
Dick. Malfunction. Dick. Malfunction.
These Gravorians will pay dearly for this, my friend.
Now, what's a space adventure film without a trusty robot sidekick, huh? Am I right? In the original draft, we had Dick and Scarlet team up with an alien from the planet's surface. You know the type, pointy ears, wise and emotionless. But then we came to our senses and realized that a giant tin can robot's way cooler. Besides, everybody was doing the alien thing back then. You know me, I'd rather be a trailblazer.